So how are you doing?
I'm in Toronto. Great.
Is Toronto just always comfortable and easy? Is that like your place?
As a film festival, it's absolutely wonderful.
And are you here much outside of the film festival?
Yeah. I mean, I come here from time to time. I was just here about a month ago where I interviewed my father over in the Lightbox, and I'll come see my family. But yeah, when I think about this film festival, this is, frankly, when I'm making a movie, I think about this film festival.
Huh. So last night was your premiere here?
Last night.
Happy-go-lucky?
Yeah, it was really nice. I mean, I love that theater. I love the Ryerson Theater. You know, four of my five movies have had their premiere in there. Mm-hmm. And the audience is wonderful there. The real movie fans, people who line up around the block to see movies the way I used to when I was a kid. And, I don't know. It's the audience I think about while I'm making my film. I mean, that's who I think about. Are they going to laugh? Are they going to be into it? Are they going to be scared? Are they going to get involved?
And a nice tribute to your mom last night.
Oh, thank you very much.
That was very sweet.
Thank you.
So where did this start? I mean, it's obviously everybody's probably opening line is this is unexpected, but where did you start?
Was it that unexpected?
Well, drama. I mean, this is pretty much a straight drama. It's not a comedy in any way, really. So, and it has a couple light moments, but.
I guess so. You know, it's funny. I think of myself as a storyteller, not a comedian. And because of that, it didn't seem that unusual choice to me. Mm-hmm. You know, my producer, Helen Esterbrook, sent me the book, and I fell for it. Just fell head over heels for it in ways that you never know why when it happens. You only can kind of explain later on. Mm-hmm. But I adapted the book into a screenplay and went out to Josh and went out to Kate, and they both said yes. However, Kate was going to be unavailable for a year, so we waited. And during that time, I made Young Adult. Mm-hmm. And by the time I was done, Kate was available again. We made the movie.
So was it, do you know now what it was that drew you into the book?
You know, I guess I have inklings. I mean, it's a story about inexplicable love. And I enjoy a story about characters who make decisions for reasons you can't explain at the moment. Mm. I like that there was this slow unveiling about who these two people were and what their trauma was and what brought them to each other and why their love did not make sense on paper but made sense once you felt it. I saw a way in through all three characters. I kind of understood where the boy was coming from, understood where she was coming from, understood where Josh's character was coming from. Someone pointed out today, and I would never even thought of this earlier, but I think it's very true, that there's a very strong similarity with Up in the Air, and that it's about the bond that is formed amongst strangers, about our willingness to open up and become close to people that we don't even know, in ways that we don't with the people that we know best.
Hmm. And I guess also having a male lead who's longing for something.
Well, everyone's longing. My belief is everyone is longing for something. And this is simply a story that gets into very detailed nuances of the complexity of our desires and our longings.
So was the idea that the movie would start the first act with us not really knowing or understanding? Because we were very clear on what her issues are, because the voiceover kind of clears as much as it can from a child, clarifies for us what's going on with her. But we really don't have any idea what's going on with Josh's character.
Well, you really don't understand what's going on with either character until the end.
Yeah.
It's not really until midway through the third act that you really understand who these two people are, what their histories are, and why they are actually intricate jigsaw pieces that fit each other.
Though he seems a bit more of a cipher, because I guess we're still dealing with whether he's a bad guy or good guy.
I guess so, although I don't really care about bad guys and good guys as much.
Because it's not interesting, or because it's...
I just don't believe in it, you know? I mean, look at my film career. My heroes are the head lobbyist for Big Tobacco, mm-hmm. a pregnant teenage girl, a guy who fires people for a living and proselytizes that life would be better alone, and then a woman who breaks up a marriage. I mean, these are my heroes. So, I don't really... I'm not interested in morality as a subject matter for my films. I don't think about the concept of good and evil when it comes to my movie. I leave that to comic book films. I think that people are gray. People are complex. We don't do things for simple reasons. And most things, we couldn't even explain why we do them. Certainly falling in love. Mm. And here's three people who need each other for reasons they could never explain, reasons we don't understand when we meet them, reasons we don't even completely understand by the end, but we know that they need each other and that they heal each other, and that's what I find interesting about the story.
So was the process of writing from the book hard?
Not this one. I mean, the book was so well written and the experience was so articulated that what I wanted to do was create a cinematic version of what it was like to read the book. Unlike Up in the Air and Thank You for Smoking, which were a real collaboration between my experiences and the author's experiences, and I suppose Up in the Air I felt to be almost autobiographical. This was a cinematic version of what it was like to read the book.
So was that always a consideration as you shot the movie?
Which?
That experience of reading the book?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, but it bores in immediately. So it's not as though, when you say consideration, I don't think I was on set going, I remember when I was reading the book, I felt that. It was more just, you read the book, and visuals pop in your head. And it all starts to come to life. What moments will look like.
So Josh was, part of his experience apparently was feeling like you were often saying to him, do less, do less.
Yeah. Well, here's what happens. In a movie like this, in a story like this, where the audience is trying to get information, you have to be very careful about what information you parse out from moment to moment. And every time you present a new shot that has production design in it, that has actors in it, where the actors move and say things, they're giving the audience information from which the audience is trying to discern, oh, this is who he is, and this is his intent, and he's going to do this, or he's not going to do this, or this is why he's doing this. So you have to be very careful, and I have to be somewhat controlling as a director.
Is Bring It Down a note that you've given often over your career? Is that
Probably not in those exact words, but I think less. Yes, you don't need to do so much of that, is usually what I'll say.
Because I guess your characters have been somewhat extreme and also have been very subtle.
I consider my characters very subtle. I got into a conversation on my first movie with an actor about just the concept of screaming. And I said, I don't understand why anyone ever needs to scream on screen. And he said, well, sometimes you have to yell. And I said, I don't know. I don't see any reason to yell in life, so I don't see any reason to yell on screen.
That's interesting. So you never come across a yelling scene that you... Are there yelling scenes you like in other movies that aren't yours?
I'm not a big fan of them. For instance, one of my favorite movies is Carnal Knowledge. When people think of Carnal Knowledge, they always think of Anne Margaret and Jack Nicholson yelling at each other. Mm-hmm. Not my favorite scene in the movie. I like the quiet scene of Jack Nicholson and Candace Bergen talking on the phone. I like the slideshow scene of Jack Nicholson and Arlo Guthrie at the Art Garfunkel at the end. Yeah. I prefer quiet.
See, for me that screaming sequence, it's her at the end, the breaking down quietly, relatively quietly. That's the most interesting thing about it, when she says, you know, she's doing the best she can.
Which, sorry.
Anne Margaret and Nicholson. When she's like, she can't figure out what he wants. And then finally, that's ultimately what the argument was about.
Right.
Is the quiet moment, not the Nicholson doing his loudness.
Right.
So, a great movie.
Yeah.
So what are your favorite movies besides, what kind of, are you... Do you, is it
my
70s?
Favorite movies?
Is it all early 70s?
A lot of them. I mean, Shampoo is always in that top five. Carnal Knowledge is always in that top five. Downhill Racer is in that top five. Election, not 70s, but built like a 70s movie. I don't know.
So do you study anybody as a guide to how you end up directing, or is it kind of just
any filmmakers?
Yeah.
No.
Just kind of assimilated.
No, most of these movies I saw after I started directing.
Really?
Yeah. No, I mean, if you look at what I kind of movies I was watching growing up, they were all bad 80s movies. I only started really watching film festival movies around the time I was probably 16, 17 years old when I started watching film festival movies, but they were modern film festival movies. I was watching the movies of the American Sundance movement, basically. And then it wasn't really till I got closer to 30 that I started watching older films.
Do you consider yourself part of that era of filmmakers?
I think I'm the last vestige of that moment. I think, but it's hard to consider myself part of a group of filmmakers who are a reason I became a director.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, kind of. I mean, I think it's. I feel like there's kind of a group now that you may be part of. I hadn't really thought about this before we're having this conversation, but that is in that Ashby Cassavetes
right, but
mindset
so,
more than
it's like who were the directors you're thinking when you say that group?
Well, Nichols of that period. I mean, I think Nichols
oh yeah, but that's way before me.
No, no, but who? And Ashby in the right. 70s also, and Polanski in some ways was part of it, but he was doing different work. But I mean, there's that part that was doing that, and Mazursky certainly, I think, mm-hmm. was part of that group.
Yeah.
People were doing things that had humor, but also were there were social issues, and they were great singular two or three characters in a movie who were really engaging. I don't know. It seemed like it was almost like his own little genre in that.
Yeah,
period.
And that genre kind of popped up again in the mid-90s.
Yeah.
With PTA and with Wes and Alexander Payne and with Noah Baumbach. It was a whole group of filmmakers who seemed to bring that back to life in the 90s. Yeah. And those are the directors that made me want to make movies.
Hmm. So you are actually a contemporary of all of those people.
But I'm not.
Hmm.
Because they're all 15, 20 years older than I am, and they all it was in watching their films that I wanted to become a director myself.
Mm-hmm.
So it's hard to consider myself contemporary of them because am I making sense?
You are. It's interesting. I mean, because like I said, Paul seems to me closer to your age than, say, Soderbergh.
Right.
But maybe I'm thinking Paul's all younger than he is.
How old's Paul? How old's PTA?
PTA is 43.
I was 43. All right. So I'm 35. He's 8 years older.
So you're getting closer.
Yeah. Right. So.
But you're definitely not part of the Mumblecore group. You're
no. Well, I've never made anything close to that. I mean, I really admire that, but I'm not part of that. No, I mean, I remember just being around 16 years old, seeing Slacker for the first time, and then everything that kind of came after that, and thinking of that as a movement, and realizing Sundance was a thing. Going to art house cinemas and going, oh, there's a whole other way to see movies.
Mm. So did that change choices you made as a filmmaker, or are you still?
Frankly, it made me feel, for the first time at that moment, like maybe I'm not just a film fan, maybe I could be a filmmaker.
Hmm. So do you judge your history at this point, or are you still too close to it, or not interested in doing that?
I don't. I can't tell you why, though. I right now I'm just trying to make movies.
So is that process changing for you, or does it feel the same?
It's changing in that how we watch movies seems to be changing. And the difficulty of making small personal movies has gone up. So I don't know how, and it's happening fast. I don't know how different cinema going will be within 5 years. And that'll change how difficult it is for me to make more movies that are traditional 90-minute to 2-hour movies that go into a theater versus what Soderbergh is now going to be doing as a miniseries or the kind of direct-to-download movies. Because I can't see myself making a big studio film.
Well, what do you consider a big studio film?
A movie that is not a personal film. A movie that you make for $100 million that is aimed at 4 quadrants and is directed closer to children than adults.
So success is not really the definer of ultimately whether it's the success you had with Juno, for instance,
mm-hmm.
was it still like an independent studio, essentially? It's the mindset of the independent
You gotta remember, Juno was an accident. Juno was a movie we made for $7 million. It was made as a film festival film that connected in a way that we never possibly could have known. My hope after Thank You for Smoking was maybe Juno can beat Thank You for Smoking.
Mm.
Thank You for Smoking made $25 million, and I'd be like, wow, wouldn't it be great if Juno made more?
So is it the magic of the distributor, do you think? Or just the sale or the moment?
Oh, why Juno was successful?
Yeah, compared to Thank You for Smoking or whatever.
I think if I think about it, it was the discovery of Diablo Cody. Mm. It was the discovery of Ellen Page. It was still in the midst of the discovery of Michael Cera. It was a discovery of a different side of Jason Bateman, who had just reemerged through Arrested Development. It was a discovery of Jennifer Garner. It was this music by Kimya Dawson. It was a film that had delight to it that came out in December against films that were very difficult. Brilliant, but difficult films. I think that's the best that I can speak to that. And I think it was pretty good. You know?
Well, I think audiences connected in a very real way, and that the character, as you say, Diablo, you know, the character was so fresh, and Ellen was so great in it, you know, that all those pieces kind of fit together, as you're saying. So.
Well, it was also, look, I think it, hopefully along the lines of all my films, it had really unexpected choices. You know, it's easy as time goes past to think about a film in its most kind of generic vestigial elements. You think about Juno and you're thinking about squiggle vision animation and, you know, a song by the Moldy Peaches and a hamburger phone and a line of twee dialogue. And what you forget about is a scene like Juno going into Mark Loring's basement, and it's the third act of the film. We're at the moment where things should be resolving, and instead, Jason Bateman makes a pass at Ellen Page in his basement, the potential father of this girl's unborn child. It's one of the best scenes I've ever directed. And it's dark and strange and completely unexpected. And the kind of thing that when I read in the script the first time, I went, holy shit, I need to direct this. Hmm. So I think it's moments like that that represent a scene that an audience has never seen before, that interests them and compels them and makes the ending so satisfying.
So in a movie like this one, mm-hmm. Do you have a clear thought about what you think the approach to the public should be? Is there an answer in your head about, I mean, you're with a big studio, you're not with Vantage, you're with, you know, the big Paramount. Mm-hmm. So it's a different, you know, which often has a hard time with companies, large studios tend to have a hard time with movies that are layered like this one is.
I've been lucky in that Paramount has had a fair amount of success that way, and I think they did a great job with Up in the Air. To be perfectly honest, when I go to make a film, my presumption is that if there is something I see in it that I connect with, mm-hmm. then other people are going to connect with it. I can't worry too much about why something's going to make money when I go to make it. And that's why I make smaller films.
Mm-hmm. So does something like Young Adult, where, I mean, a great film with a great performance, mm-hmm. that didn't quite connect at the box office the way people expected it to, was that a hit on the chin? Or is it, for you, you already did the
Frankly,
work?
Frankly, no. If I had made Young Adult for $100 million, then it would have been a hit on the chin. Mm-hmm. And I would feel embarrassed for having spent that much money on something that there was no way it could ever make the money back. But Young Adult was so cheap and shot in the same amount of days that I shot Thank You for Smoking Juno, and shot in 30 days, mm-hmm. That people like the film. And that's kind of all that matters to me. You know, when directors come up and talk to me, the one film they want to talk to me about is Young Adult. So when I hear the relationship people have with it, mm-hmm. when I hear women come up to talk to me and say, wow, I've never seen a main character on screen like that, then for me it's an unequivocal success, no matter how little money it made.
So do you have a feeling about this? I mean, we've been a lot of conversation about this week, about every few hours at the festival this year, there being another Oscar-winning movie and Oscar-winning performance. Are you not a fan of that? Are you
who's
conscious
to
of it?
Say, who's to say what's going to happen? Look, the best thing about the Oscars and awards in general is that they draw attention to films that otherwise don't get any attention. For a film where it is not naturally going to have a high marketing budget, these kinds of awards can convince people who would otherwise not see them to see them. So it's great that there are a lot of films that are getting this kind of talk. There's no way to learn to know what is going to win and what's not going to win. Mm-hmm. I've come close to winning and I've come very far away. And even when I think about it now, I'm not quite sure what the difference was in the different experiences. So what I hope for every film I make is that it reaches people. You know, I don't make movies in a complete vacuum. I don't want nobody to see my film. I want them to speak to audiences. And I hope the best for them.
But your state, you don't have like a set idea of this is success, this is not success. You're having that in the filmmaking.
I think it takes a lot of time, frankly. I mean, look, I think there's one version of success, which is, did I enjoy the process of making the film? Did I find joy in it? And did I achieve the type of film that I went out to make and hit the beats that I wanted as I looked into it? And I've been very lucky with each film in that I've worked with amazing writers and amazing actors mm-hmm. and a family of crew that I've developed over the course of five films that have allowed me to achieve my results, the ones that I was looking after. And there's moments that I hit better than others. And then after that, I've been really lucky in that my movies have reached large audiences, and I know that sometimes they won't, sometimes they won't.
But that's not what you crave. That's not what you're doing.
No, if I wanted to reach larger audiences, I would make different movies. There are certainly easier movies to make if you want to just make $500 million and right. have a billion people see your movie. Mm-hmm. And those movies are available. That's, at the moment, not why I make films.
So I'm going to stop pushing you for Star Wars 8.
I'm not sure if you would want to see my Star Wars 8.
I think we'd love to see your Star Wars 8.
You
actually.
In particular might, but I think for the most part people wouldn't. And that's fine. And look, maybe one day I will make a transition into large-scale genre films. I'll be good at it. And maybe I'll even direct one of the Star Wars films. But at the moment, that seems highly improbable. Improbable. I really love making the kinds of films I do. There's a few different stories that I want to tell right now. Mm-hmm. And God willing, I'll still be allowed to make them. And that kind of filmmaking will be available.
So what was it about Josh that made this work for you? Let's go from Star Wars to Josh's goatee.
All right. What about Josh? One, I like the guy. Really like the guy. Great friend, great actor, fun to work with. And that's actually a huge part of it. Two, I needed an actor who could somehow be menacing and romantic simultaneously. Mm. Who could tie Kate Winslet to a chair and then go into the kitchen and make chili and spoon feed it to her in front of her son. I don't know any other actors who can do that. Who can really achieve that balance. Mm. And it was exciting for me to direct Josh to a performance that was as charming and as handsome as that character is, because he so often ducks that stuff. He is so often trying to be a character actor hidden amongst, you know, under an accent, hiding under what are they called? Prosthetics. Mm-hmm. And it was fun for me to make a movie where he played just as handsome as he actually is.
Mm. And Kate was not a hard choice, I guess.
Not hard at all. I mean, it may have been a hard choice for her, but for me, it was easy. I wanted to work with Kate. And of course, she seemed perfect for this role, a role of a nuanced, vulnerable, broken woman who is sensual and needs to heal. I mean, this is her expertise.
Yeah.
And
keep on waiting for it to not work anymore, and yet it keeps on working. It's amazing.
No. She's like Streep. I mean, she's just getting better and better and is never bad in anything.
She is. And the kid was hard to find, or?
Yeah, indeed hard to find. I mean, we looked at a lot of young men in New York and Los Angeles. And he just has unbelievable eyes. He reminded me, strangely, like a young River Phoenix. You know, mm-hmm. there's a similar kind of sensitivity there. And I needed to see the whole movie through his eyes, over his shoulders. Mm-hmm. And again, have another character who doesn't talk much. It's just how he looks at stuff. And he was perfect.
And that is, I guess that is, of all the things, of the many things that are different about this movie.
Yeah, exactly. No talking.
No talking is a big deal. Was that part of the pleasure for you? To
You know, again, it's so funny. It's only through these discussions, mm-hmm. months after the movie is done, that I sit here and for the first time think, oh, I guess this movie is different from my other movies. And I guess I was trying this. You know, certainly I knew that I had to shoot this in a unique way. And it was a timepiece, which was unique for me. And there's certain things that, of course, I had to address with the people I work with. But the concept that this was a non-talking movie wasn't something that I was going after or even thinking about while I was making it. It's only after I go, huh, yeah, we really had to visually sell this movie without the dialogue.
Well, you think you and your DP weren't having that conversation? And
it's when my DP and I are talking, we're talking about the intent of the scene, the tone of the scene, the mood of the scene, what story we're trying to tell. Never do we say, well, as we know, this movie has very little dialogue, and because of that, we're going to have to tell it in a new way. You know, that's only the kind of conversation you can have as a film historian, not in the throes of making it, at least from my experience.
So did it feel any different on the set than other films you've made?
I mean, it did in that, and I didn't think about this, but it did in that I was directing moves instead of dialogue. And there was 300 scenes instead of 100 scenes because of all the flashback work.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a specificity to doing timepiece work, particularly in 1980s, because everyone knows the 80s.
And I don't, there was a big laugh when the date came on the movie last night.
That was funny, yeah.
I didn't really get why they were laughing, though.
Oh, because everyone was clapping for every
right
credit that came up. And then 1987 came up as if it was another credit, and people laughed at it.
Okay.
I thought that was pretty funny.
Did I miss something? Did I look away?
No. I thought that was pretty funny. But that's what's great about it, the Toronto crowd. They're so in. They're so hyper aware. They're so excited to see movies.
So do you trust that the love fest last night is going to be typical of other audiences, or do you?
No, I don't think. But what they are is a highly attuned version of what people will feel.
Mm. And you watched it last night with the audience?
Yeah.
So was that the first time you'd seen it with a big audience, or I guess you tested it?
We do test screenings. We were at Telluride, and
I forgot about Telluride.
It's a wonderful new experience to watch this film with an audience.
And will you watch it with an audience again, or are you done?
Maybe one more time. I don't know.
And then once you've seen, if you see it the one more time, you do then not watch it for a very long time or avoid it? Or?
You know, I've had my movies come on like HBO before, and I'll watch some of them and just kind of see how I did.
Mm. Now you actually have to click on it on Netflix. You can barely wander into a movie anymore.
No, but I've got the 13 channels of HBO and everything, and I'll wander into like Juno or Up in the Air, and I'll be like, oh, well, that works. I think I did an all right job there.
And do you now just take a breath for a moment and think about the next film?
Or absolutely not. I want to make my next movie as soon as possible. It's written and I'm ready to go.
So you want to knock them out one every other year, one every year?
You know, I have been on a one every other year since I started making films. I've had a film come out every 2 years, but I feel very grateful that I get to make movies. I don't know how long filmmaking in its current state will exist, and I just want to keep making movies.
So you're really concerned that it will stop, that we'll all end up on television and that'll become the...
My concern is I just don't know exactly where we're at right now. I don't have the same doom and gloom that you've heard from some other filmmakers, but what I do know is things are changing. I don't know which way. And as long as I can make movies the way I've been making them, I'd like to continue.
Because you're a producer as well as director. You do produce things.
Yes.
So you have that perspective as well, I guess.
I suppose so, but I just have the perspective of someone who loves movies and sees the world changing.
Mm. So for you, going into the theater and sitting in that dark room with a lot of people is still the experience we all want to have.
Oh, well, absolutely. I think the magic of movies is, again, and it goes back to what I said about experiencing things with strangers, is being connected to people you don't know. And not just laughing together, but weeping together, emotionally feeling things together, having that deeper sense of humanity because you are connected to everyone else as you feel it.
Mm. Not many other ways to get it anymore.
No. No, things have become... things have become so disparate, which is probably why my next movie is about how the internet has changed our lives.
Are you going to call it the fucking internet or something else?
Am I going to call it the what?
The fucking internet.
No, what's that?
No, just I think it's a phrase that I hear a lot. Is the, you know?
Oh no, it's
the fucking
not,
internet.
No.
This the fucking internet that.
No,
that
it's not.
Destroyed our lives.
No, it's not called that. That's funny though.
Is it based on anything, or is it just
It's
original?
Based on a book called Men, Women, and Children.
Mm. And so we should look forward to that in the year, next year?
Maybe? I don't know. That would be nice, eh?
Get it, just line them up. We'll watch them. Your track record is still blemished, so it's...
That's very kind of you. Thank you for saying so.
Well, you don't think so?
Oh, it's a matter of opinion, and I really appreciate yours.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Awesome. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Indeed.